We may celebrate freedom, but we don't value freedom. We don't try to safeguard freedom, strengthen freedom, enrich freedom. That's why I said we don't value freedom. And this is a reality. And one proof that a person does not value freedom is that he does not respect the freedom of others. The proof that you really care for freedom is not that you clamor for your freedom. It is that you become a defender of the freedom of others. Right? And it is this kind of authentic freedom that we need to create. And unfortunately, nothing, absolutely nothing, is being done in this direction. And this is one of the greatest paradoxes in the human context, paradoxes in history, that human beings who value freedom theoretically above everything else are also enemies of freedom. Slavery is a theme, is a reality that continues to run like a red thread through the tapestry of history. No age, no society, no culture has been free from slavery of various kinds. For example, in India, we have the problem of bonded labor. What is bonded labor? People who are forced to work without their work being properly compensated. They are bonded because they can work only for a certain person or persons. Their freedom is abolished. They cannot leave for better opportunities. They are bonded. So bonded labor is one of the contemporary forms of slavery. Now, there are various other forms. I don't want to go into this. What I want to do at this stage is to leave with you certain questions, and I'm not going to say much about or perhaps anything at all about these questions now. We can perhaps discuss them during the question session, question answer session. The first question is, it is not there in the slides because these things came to me only about an hour ago. The first question is, am I free? If I am, to what extent? You might think that this is a strange question, but when we discuss it, you will realize that this is a very relevant, pertinent question. Am I free? If I am, to what extent? Second question, do I value freedom? And the second part of that is, what does it mean to value freedom? Third question, do we have a culture of freedom? Right? Do we have a culture of freedom? Fifth, now this is a metaphysical question or a philosophical question. What is the source of freedom? What is the source of freedom? Everything has a source. So freedom also has a source. In that case, what is the source of freedom? 6. Can man as man, now that's important. What can man as man be a safe custodian of freedom? Are we capable of looking after, safeguarding freedom? These things should not be taken for granted. All right? So, I'm going to now project a particular theme or an issue for our reflection. And I want all of you to concentrate, listen very carefully, so that we can actually continue to develop this thought. I'm going to give you a certain understanding of freedom, which I have developed over a long, long period of reflection, research, and writing. Let me explain to you how I understand freedom, or how I understand unfreedom. Unfreedom is not the same as slavery. The opposite of freedom must be unfreedom. Now, is man, and I'm going to take up that question as an introduction to this, is man a safe or trustworthy or responsible custodian of freedom? Can man be a safe custodian of freedom if he cannot be? What is the problem? Why is it that human beings cannot be good enough custodians of freedom? I'm proceeding very slowly so that we can think together. All right? I've not come here for a performance. I've come here to serve you. So let us stay together, think, and enter deeply into a subject. Now, I must say this to you with some reservation and humility, that what is lacking in this age of materialism and media domination is an awareness of depth. We have created a way of life in which surface alone matters, and therefore our understanding of subjects or issues or themes or problems or experiences is very shallow. And shallowness is the logic of poverty. Intellectual poverty is shallowness. Human poverty in the experiential sense is shallowness. What all of us, for example, in our relationships thirst for is the experience of depth. And what disappoints us in our experience of a fellow human being is shallowness. Right? And what is shallowness? Now, I'm not going to answer that question now. I will answer that question. But let me take up this other question which I have already posited. Namely, why is it that human beings as human beings, it's very important that part, human beings as human beings, poor custodians of human freedom? It's one of the greatest issues for me. And I've wrestled with this problem for years. And this is what I understand now. Don't look at these slides because it's not in the slides. Because I initially thought I will exclude this because it's a little demanding. But I now feel convinced that it has to be introduced right at the outset itself. Because I trust you, and I'm sure you will make a lot of sense out of what I'm going to say. Now, what is our limitation as individuals? Our limitation is that we are only a part. We are a very small part. We are, important though we are so limited. I cannot look beyond my nose. I cannot understand things a little beyond my backyard. My concerns, my intellectual, spiritual engagements are so limited. Now, if you were to really examine your daily life as I do every day, you will be astonished, perhaps you would be embarrassed. What a trivial life we are leading. We don't have to do that. We can actually shift the gear of our life tremendously. We can live on a very, very high level. And in fact, this was the spiritual project from the beginning of times. Spiritual invitation or spiritual exhortation is for human beings to come to a much higher plane of living. Now, I said a short while ago that every individual is a limited part. Now, part always means that there is a whole, right? Now, for example, you are part of this group. And now, there is no point in saying, I am part. Part of what? So, part always implies there is no part without a whole, W-H-O-L-E, right? Part of a sentence, there must be a sentence for the part of the sentence to exist. Part of a song, there must be a song, right? So, there definitely is the whole. You know, for example, the word Brahmanda, what does it mean? It means the whole, isn't it? Right? Now, for example, truth. Why is it that truth often gets rejected? Truth becomes a casualty? Because truth is always a function of the whole. You take an episode and look at only a small part, you can create a horrible story as is happening. You understand? And this is what all the time we are doing. We are looking at a small part and then saying that's all there is to it. Right? Now, for example, you have a quarrel with somebody. Okay? And from that time onwards, you will only remember that small part about him or her. Till you quarreled, that person was a complete human being. The moment quarrel happens, that person is reduced to a small little thing, like he said this to me, that's all. The person doesn't exist anymore, that one sentence exists. Now this is our problem. In all aspects of life, this is our problem. And this problem has a serious bearing on our capacity for freedom. Freedom belongs to the whole. Now, I want you to understand this very clearly because it is not understood. Now, let me illustrate so that this becomes clear. When a person offends the law of the land or commits a crime, and it is established that he has indeed committed a crime, he is convicted and sent to a prison. Right? Okay? Now this all of us know. There are convicts. And what is the meaning of somebody being sent to a prison? It means that he is now required to lead a life in a very small part. You understand? His freedom is limited and compromised. He still has freedom. In the prison also, you can run around, you can play, you can work, you can fight, you can quarrel, you can sit and dream, and the prison perhaps, if you are good enough, you can also write a novel, all that you can do. But you are limited to a part of the country, right? A prison is a part of the country. An Indian prison exists in India, it belongs to India, right? But it's a very small part of India. That is the problem. From this illustration itself, you will be able to understand that freedom belongs to the whole. And when you are not allowed or enabled, and I'm using my words very carefully, when you are not allowed or enabled to be part of the whole, then your freedom is meaningless. For example, during times of war, your freedom of movement will be curtailed. Your freedom of speech will be curtailed. Individual freedoms will be kept in a state of suspended animation in times of emergency or crisis, national crisis. So you're still in the country. You're still an Indian, but there is a limitation. So you're allowed to be only in this part. Now, this is not a problem for other animals, as far as we know. It is not such a big problem for, if you, for example, limit the movement of a dog or a cat, as domesticated animals in any case are, it's not such a philosophical problem. But for human beings, it is such a huge problem. For example, the question of freedom becomes an agonizing question in the context of relationships. Some people feel suffocated within relationships because that's the nature of the relationship. A relationship which is constructed on what is narrow, what is shallow, and what rejects the whole will be a prison. You understand? A relationship can be a prison. For example, you're all familiar with the concept of the jealous husband, right? Goodness gracious me. A jealous husband is your prison. Because he is insecure when you turn to the left or to the right, look this way or that way, right? Because of his insecurity, he has to freeze you into a lifeless object. Only then does he feel safe and secure. You understand? So in such a context, the constitution is there. All your fundamental freedoms are written in the constitution, but in your daily life, it doesn't exist at all. You understand? Or take the condition of a society. Now, just as an individual can be like this jealous husband, a jealous husband is an insecure person whose insecurity has reached the level of pathology, sick with distrust. You understand? This disease is called distrust. All right? Just as an individual can be sick with distrust, a society can also be infected with hatred, distrust, anger, violence, and rendered exactly the same as the case of a jealous husband, suspicious husband. And in such a society, the ordeal of freedom is real. Freedom gets limited. Freedom is always under threat. And freedom becomes, to borrow an expression from the Supreme Court of India, a teasing illusion. Freedom becomes a teasing illusion. It's a good phrase. Now, therefore, and I want this to be very clearly understood, the pilgrimage of freedom perhaps I can't use a better expression for it. The pilgrimage of freedom is the movement from the limited part to the whole. That is freedom. And this is what I often describe as growth. What is growth? When you grow, your mind enlarges, your perceptions increase, your sympathies and affinities grow, your ability to understand increases. So it is like a kind of, it's a ripple which spreads outwards, right? And human beings have this thirst to grow outwards and enfold more and more and more. Deep down in our hearts, there is a thirst to be one with the whole. You understand? That is why we sit and dream. All of us have dreamt of great things. What are great things? Great things belong not to the narrow part, but to the whole. You understand? For example, life becomes worth living when there is a great cause to serve. And what is that great cause? It is something that takes me out of myself and incorporates me, embeds me into the whole. During the freedom movement, the generation previous to yours, I was somewhere in between, experienced the acceleration of that engagement with the whole. The great contribution of Mahatma Gandhi, who was the instrument of our freedom, our liberation, was to liberate individuals from their small little pockets and ghettos and give them a vision that transcended all parochial, regional, linguistic, caste considerations, religious considerations, gender considerations, class considerations, and to enable them without any difference to experience the exhilaration of belonging to India. You understand? That itself is freedom. That itself is liberation. India was liberated not on the 15th of August 1947. India was liberated. India turned her face to freedom when? Through Mahatma Gandhi and a host of people who worked with him sharing this vision. The individuals that constituted the body politic of India were liberated from their narrow little places and enabled to feel for the country. You understand? Now that feeling is very important for us. I say this because this feeling is now almost dying out. So what is the secret of freedom? Freedom is the byproduct of belonging to the whole. For example, suppose I entertain a prejudice. What is a prejudice? All prejudices belong to the narrow, small little hole. Prejudice is a wall that stands between me and the whole, the complete thing. Every prejudice, therefore, limits my freedom. If I really believe in my freedom, I should cast away all prejudices. You understand? Now, the problem with prejudice is the grammar of the small part. For example, some people are prejudiced about members of some other group. All right? For example, St. Stephen's College. Let me talk about my college. You know, an attitude was created according to which it was a fashionable thing to look down upon the students of Hindu college. or they are inferior. As a result, even though we are next door neighbors, we were never free to extend our arms of love and touch them. No one could cross the road in between. The very first thing I did on becoming the principal of the college is to cross that road. I walked into the office of the principal of Hindu College. He was shocked and he said, "Look, you're the first principal of St. Stephen's College to come into the Hindu College." Because there was a prejudice. If I believe in freedom, I would want to sweep away all prejudices, because prejudices kill my freedom. One aspect of the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan must be the sweeping away of prejudices. That is true Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. How can you have a clean India full of prejudices? Understand? Now, Satyameva Jayate Nanuradam, right? What does it mean? Victory, Satyameva Jayate, truth alone shall triumph. Triumph in history has always something to do with freedom. Your freedom. It also has something to do with the loss of freedom by somebody else. Suppose there is a war. There will be a triumphant celebration or procession. A triumphal procession when the victor will be taken out as a hero and all the people will worship in the olden days. Right? So there is the historical overtone of freedom in this. Okay? Triumph. But the real triumph, is the triumph I achieve over myself. The liberation that I achieve, and that liberation is breaking away the shackles of the part and finding my place within the whole, gladly accepting all the limitations that go with it, because those limitations are the quintessence of freedom. Now, I've said something extremely thought-provoking. I hope you realize what I've said. I've just now said those limitations are the boundaries of that. I'll use the word quintessence of freedom. Now, let me take you to an important issue. Have you understood this much? All right. Now, I'm going to introduce another important theme. I hope I have the ability to communicate it properly. India became free on paper at the stroke of the midnight hour when the whole world sleeps. India will awake to life and freedom. Right? Nehru's great rhetoric. When the soul of a nation long suppressed finds utterance. Right? Yes. Is freedom merely the departure of the colonizer, the master, the British? Do we really become, as a people in the true sense of the term, or so far I've been trying to give you a taste of freedom in a very inadequate fashion. I'm aware of the limitations of what I have said, but I trust your intelligence and imagination, your participative inquiry into this, so that I can really sort of move on. Otherwise, I'll get stuck here for a long, long time. Now, let me give you an illustration from the Bible. I hope you don't mind. Can I? Anyone who has a problem? Okay. Now, one of the most exciting books in the Bible for me is the second book called the Exodus. Exodus is the account of the liberation of Jews who were slaves in Egypt for nearly five centuries. Right? So it's one of the greatest books ever written, on the saga of liberation and the march to freedom. Okay? You must, every word that I say is significant. You must register these things. Now what happens is, through the agency of Moses, Moses came into the picture and he led them out of their slavery into freedom. But between Egypt, which was the land of their slavery, and Canaan, which is the land of their freedom, the home of their freedom, there is a 40-year-long march. You must understand, it's very symbolic. It is not that the Jews were allowed to leave Egypt, the home of their slavery, and suddenly they became free. It cannot happen. Because a people have to be prepared for freedom. Please understand. Do not take freedom for granted. Because man has the potential to be a mortal enemy to freedom. He's also the passionate dreamer for freedom. He's also murderous in his attitude to freedom. That is a paradox of human nature. So there is a real need to prepare the people of India for freedom. No work was done. It was taken for granted. And the moment freedom came, bloodshed began. That itself was a loud statement of the imperative need for training and preparing people for freedom. That work is still to begin. And I believe that there is no agenda more important than this, that is rooting freedom in the minds and the lives of the people. In comparison to this work, India becoming a superpower is not as exciting. In my opinion, India must become not a superpower, but a proper power. How can you become a proper power? How can you become a superpower before you become a proper power? And how can you become a proper power if you don't have a culture of freedom? I know I'm saying things not very popular. These are things that nobody likes. But I have to be a voice in the wilderness. Because all my life was devoted to this. I'm nothing else. I have to share this with you. You understand? So, we have to prepare ourselves for freedom. And that is a huge agenda. Now, education, for example, is meant to liberate people. The outcome of education must be enlightenment. Today it has become employment. Enlightenment has been substituted with employment. I'm not saying that employment is a bad thing. Employment is a very good thing. It's a great thing. It's a must. But what is employment if it does not have enlightenment? One does not exclude the other. We must have both. And I would say that employment must be a byproduct of enlightenment. India's great, basic problem is our bad work culture. What is bad work culture? It's the absence of the freedom to enter into the fullness of your work and responsibilities. That is bad work culture. Everything in life is touched by the theme of freedom. That's why I thought I would talk about it. We have to really wake up to the fact that every aspect of our life, including sitting and listening, is touched by freedom. Are you free, for example, to sit and listen? Who knows? Because every now I am told that in the modern culture, everybody is restless. There is a problem of attention deficiency, which is induced by culture. 50 years ago, there was no problem. Now, because of the modern culture, don't expect people to sit and listen to you for more than 10 minutes. 15 minutes, people will faint. Now, you're not free to listen. You understand what I'm saying? Everything in life is touched by the theme of freedom. Can you relate to your neighbor? Has become one of our contemporary problems. I cannot relate to my neighbor. Or as students, when you come to college, are you really free to study? You're not. Suppose you allow yourself to be distracted. Well, what does distraction mean? Distraction means the willing, voluntary compromise of my freedom to study. That's what it means. So please understand, everything in life is touched by the theme of freedom. Okay, so therefore you must understand, and I'm sure you will understand, the importance of preparing ourselves for freedom. And that was actually the foundational purpose in my conceiving this course. Citizenship and Cultural Richness course was conceived on this concern of empowering the citizens of Delhi to be truly free. We are not free. Now, we talk about the problems in the city. Okay, violence. What does violence mean? What does violence mean? It's also touched by the problem of freedom. The insecurity of women, freedom. If you can enunciate a culture of freedom, and through this lecture I would appeal to the Delhi government, I would also appeal to the central government to concentrate on and do all you can to enunciate a culture of true freedom. And that alone will solve these problems. By adding to your police force, you aggravate your problem. By creating an adversarial relationship between the male and the female, which is happening now, you will aggravate your problem. You will further reduce your freedom to relate to each other. Some of my colleagues are now saying, sir, we feel very insecure when we have to teach girl students. Who knows what will happen? What can we do? Our freedom is on the line. It's being strangulated. We do not know what we are doing to ourselves. You understand? So, there is a huge case for preparing ourselves for freedom. Now, when you look at freedom, now that's the next stage of my argument. The ingredients of freedom, see, just as if you want to make chapati, if you make chapati at all, most people these days eat from some joint or the other. You need atta, you need a little salt, you need a little water, and some people add a little oil also. If your taste buds demand a little bit more of taste, you add. Some people add maybe something more. All kinds of cereals will be added, whatever it is. So there are ingredients, right? To create anything, there are ingredients. And the same applies to the culture of freedom. All right? Now, the culture of freedom has to be created with the ingredients called values. Values are the ingredients of freedom. For example, now this must be very clearly, thoroughly, deeply understood. If you want to ask questions anytime, please feel free to interrupt me. I'll be only happy. Because it is imperative that we understand things very clearly, because these things are simply swept under the carpet and we are living in a very confused world. We need clarity in this age. Otherwise, we'll lose life. We'll never live. You may exist on planet Earth for 100 years, but you'll never live even for a day. Now, I said that values are the ingredients for creating a culture of freedom. Now, let me illustrate. One of the universal values is love. Okay? What is love? Now, in love, you experience a thirst for the other. Am I right? Right? Yes, of course I'm right. Okay? You know, the story of Laila, Majnu, Yebo, huh? What does it mean? The man in love is willing to risk his life in order to attain the presence of the lady love. Right? Oh, that belongs to the past. Now, because of technology, huh? It's only an SMS. So all heroism that our folklore associated with, perhaps the previous generation associated with the adventure of loving, is gone. And just a click of the button and that's it. Okay? I will see you if there is no rain. That kind of thing. So, I mean, we've lost a lot and we are still losing a lot. Now, the mark of love is that it is impelled by a desire to go from the part to the whole. And as our capacity for love grows, improves, becomes more and more mature, the circle of that love increases, grows, and involves more and more and more people. You, for example, I mean, we started our journey by loving our parents, right? Only our parents. And if somebody else came to carry us, we cried, right? We felt so insecure. And then a stage came when we were able to play with the children in the neighborhood. Then we went to school. From there, we went to college. From college, we went to the wider world. And then to the still wider world. And then we got lost. Right? But doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. What is the pattern in all this? The pattern is simple. The journey from the part to the whole. Now we talk about the universal citizen, the global citizen. We talk about the global citizen, right? Who is a global citizen? A global citizen is one who in his mind, his affinities, his imagination, and his sense of responsibility has grown and transcended all usual boundaries and limitations. Therefore, a global citizen is one without boundaries. And a person without boundaries is a member of the whole. You understand? That is called freedom. That is called freedom. If this state is not attained, no matter how profound your constitution is, and the Indian constitution is a fantastic document, but it will mean nothing to you. I mean, the constitution says that nobody shall be discriminated on the basis of caste, religion, sex, etc., gender. But what is happening on the ground? Why does the constitution say that you shall not discriminate? Because the moment you discriminate, you are actually undermining freedom. Discrimination is an atrocity on freedom. We think that discrimination is something that we do to people. No, discrimination is an atrocity on freedom. Every act of violence is wounding freedom. This understanding does not exist. In my life as a teacher, for 40 years I've been struggling and struggling to bring about this mental change. This is what I call the Copernican Revolution. You know what Copernican Revolution is? It's a paradigm shift. Ptolemy believed that the earth was stationary and the sun went round the earth, right? That's a Ptolemaic system. The structure of the universe that Ptolemy believed in. Okay? Actually, it's a good illustration of what I'm saying. It's a cosmic illustration of a terrestrial principle. Now, earth is such a small little speck in the infinite majesty of the universe, right? It's actually a very, humbling realization. This earth that we are so proud of, upon which we strut, is only a small little speck in the infinitude of the universe, right? So, up until the time of Copernicus, this idea went on. And Copernicus said that it is not that the sun goes around the earth, the earth goes around the sun. In other words, the earth belongs to a much larger unit, right? So the same principle, from the part to the whole. Okay? That's called freedom. You look at any aspect of life, from the terrestrial to the cosmic, the pattern I have shared with you will hold. And I believe firmly that is the best way to understand freedom. Okay? So, what is the conclusion to which we have to arrive now in the understanding and practice of freedom? What does it mean to be free? Now, these are questions we will look at in the, we'll discuss in the next part of the session. Now, the project of liberating people was at the center of every spiritual tradition. If you look at the work of all spiritually enlightened people, whether it be Guru Nanak, whether it is Prophet Muhammad, whether it is Lord Buddha, whether it is Jesus of Nazareth, Lord Mahavira, whoever, one thing is very clear. What is common to the activities, common to the vision, common to the exhortation of all these spiritually enlightened luminaries, the true spiritual lights of the world? The pattern is exactly this. Now, let me give you a story from the life of Guru Nanak. I don't know if I've shared this story before. Guru Nanak had an ardent devotee by the name Duni Chand, who lived in Lahore. But Duni Chand was a shopkeeper, and he was very materialistic, fond of worldly things. And the Guru, of course, knew that this is a very limiting factor. By the way, love for material things is a limiting factor. Why? Because all material things are a very small part. And that is actually, I must actually explain this to you. In all spiritual teachings, you have this idea that the love of the of material things stands in the way of your spiritual growth. Why? Because whatever you love limits who you are. Now, suppose I love my car, then I become that car. I'm nothing more than that car. Suppose I become music, I love music, then for me it's only music. There are people who love cricket, and all the time they'll be talking about cricket. All right? They are cricket. And actually they produce the noise of the cricket also, that creature. Huh? So, when you love material things, every material thing is limited. For example, this microphone is a material thing. It is limited. Now, suppose I love a microphone. And I, all the time, all my life, I stand holding the microphone, admiring the microphone. This is all I do. What has happened to me? I have limited my life pathetically. And this happens to individuals. When we examine ourselves, we all know that there are certain objects that we love exclusively, and because of that, we are excluded from the wider world. This happens in the life of everyone, and we have to be very careful about it. So, this problem existed from the very beginning of times. Every person who was spiritually enlightened, without exception, in his teachings and his public work, sought to set people free. In fact, freedom is the most dynamic concept in spirituality. You know this? Now, let me answer the question I raised at the beginning. Why is it that man cannot be a safe and good enough custodian of freedom? Man as man. We can become. We can become good custodians of freedom. But why is it that man as man cannot be a good enough custodian of freedom? When you look at history, we know history is nothing but the cruelty of man to man. That's what history is. Why is it so? All right, I'll just suggest something, then close at 5 o'clock, we'll have tea. We come back for a time of discussion. Actually, I have not used anything from the slide so far, so maybe next time we'll take it up, okay? It's all because of your goodness that, you know, thoughts come to me and I get drawn into other areas of reflection, doesn't matter. Now, the reason why man as man cannot be a good custodian, trustworthy custodian of freedom is that every human being is limited. And therefore, he understands at best only Also, when you are obsessed only with freedom for yourself, you get into the delusion that the freedom of others is a threat to my freedom. This is a problem with the individual. When the individual is limited in his perception, in his understanding, he wants freedom for himself, but at the same time thinks of everyone else, especially everyone else who differs from him or is different from him, as a threat to his freedom. Now, this is a public admission of one's own limitation. Nobody can be a threat to your freedom. This is, I believe, the mercy of God and the justice of God to all of us, that nobody else has been given the authority to take away your freedom without your consent. Even in the worst of circumstances, the worst circumstance imaginable was the concentration camp of Hitler's Germany, right? Auschwitz. But in the Auschwitz, there was a doctor called Viktor Frankl who wrote one of the best books ever in the concentration camp, Man's Search for Meaning. So, even when people try to murder and throttle your freedom, you can still hold on to your freedom. And that's the greatness and beauty of life. But remember that unless we outgrow the usual familiar limitations of individuals, none of us will become responsible and safe custodians of freedom. We will all become insecure because of the freedom of others. I'll give you a variation of the same thing, which all of us have experienced. You know, when someone is seen to be doing well, we experience a heartburn, right? Okay? You remember the school days? Somebody got 2 marks more than I did. You know, it's a very difficult feeling, right? On the other hand, it's possible to look at the same situation in this manner. Yes, wonderful. No, he today is working hard, doing well. I can also do it. Let me do it. Okay? And I will study not to outstrip him, not to get ahead of him. I will study in order to master mathematics. I may or may not get good marks, but I am going to enjoy mathematics. That's called freedom in the study of mathematics. On the other hand, if I want to compete with him and then kick him by outscoring him, then I'm not free, I'm still a slave. You understand? So, we have to ask ourselves what we have to do and in which respect we have to change in order to become good custodians of freedom. If I don't rejoice in the freedom of my neighbor, If I don't use my freedom in order to enhance the freedom of another, then there is something wrong with it. I still remember the speech that Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru made when he presented the Indian national flag to the parliament. You know what he said? He said, "This is not just a piece of cloth. This flag which we adopt and accept today is a sign and a promise of freedom. Freedom not only for us, but freedom for every people anywhere in the world who are struggling in slavery." In other words, Nehru recognized quite rightly that if you are free, you must be responsible for the freedom of others. Right? My dear friends, in the domain of higher education, I express my commitment to freedom through my commitment to social justice. Because we are living in a country where many people are systemically excluded. That's not a sign of freedom at all. That's a sign of slavery. Why is it that in this country, the enrollment rate in higher education is less than 9%? That is to say, if there are 100 people, young people, who could have been enrolled into colleges and universities, only 9 of them would make it. Why? Because we created a mindset of insecurity and a system of exclusion. And that is why I am 100% clear in my mind that the best and most radical expression of my patriotism, my love for my country, is my commitment to social justice. Because for me, India is not an abstraction. India is her people. We talk about the sava sav crore log, right? 125 crore people. Who are they and where are they? How many of them are free? How many of them are empowered? How many of them can grow and express themselves? How many of them have basic conditions for living? Not just in rural India, tribal, but even in the cities, cosmopolitan cities. How many of them? My dear friends, I'm going to close on stating this absolute conviction of mine, and that is, if we can truly propagate in spirit and in truth, a culture of freedom, India will be transformed. We do not as yet have a mindset of freedom. And I'm making a very radical and provocative statement, I'm aware of it. We do not have a mindset of freedom. We don't have a culture of freedom. We don't have a worldview of freedom. India is an amazing prospect. I don't think there is any other country in the world comparable to our country. I've had occasion at least to know at very close quarters 18 nations that I visited fairly regularly, addressing people all over. But no other country, no other culture, no other people stimulates me to the extent that India does. I'm a believer in the glorious destiny of India. At the same time, I also sit and cry in silence over what we are doing to our country, and even in the name of education. So, we have not begun our lecture on freedom. This was only the trailer, okay? My lecture notes still remain. Now, just to illustrate to you that this is such a rich and stimulating theme that there is no end to it. And I would commend it to your own reflection and research to dwell deep into this theme and come to your own conclusion. Write a piece on this. Let it be published in the newspapers. Or share it as an email with 100 people. Every one of you must become active. I mean, the problem with us is that we are so passive.
The purpose of this course is to kill passivity. I'm using a bad word. Passivity is our problem. We have to become active. We must believe that there is something I can do. A small little thing, like the squirrel who helped Lord Rama. Right? There's something I can do. Make 2 phone calls a day. Send 5 SMSs a day. 3 emails a day. I'm doing what I can. Using the last drop of my energy. Because that's a mark of an educated person. I'm not boasting. I'm stating this on my bended knees. Please, for God's sake, in your conversations with others, let some noble theme come. Let others be blessed through a word that you utter. Let light come out of your being. Okay? That's called freedom. The freedom to be the light of the world. And that, my friends, is the most beautiful thing in the world. Not even the sea's worth, as Shakespeare says, is anywhere comparable to it. This possibility is sleeping inside each one of you. You are the light of the world. You cannot hide that light. The light must shine and dispel the darkness all around us. It will happen. Believe you me, it will happen. The world is actually thirsting for it. You try and discuss these things with your neighbors, you will see happiness on their face. The prevailing dark clouds of cynicism will be dispersed. The sun will begin to shine again on this land. And at least the next generation will know the blessing of freedom. As Martin Luther said, you know, I dream of a day, I dream of a time when the son of a black man and the son of a white man will go to school together and we'll all sit around the table and break bread. I dream of a day. I also dream of a country which recognizes its greatness, sleeping greatness, and is willing to release it and unleash it for the sake of the world. I believe that the spiritual destiny of my country must be fulfilled for the sake of the world. That's my conviction. You understand? We cannot. Now, if India wants to be a superpower, no problem. But being a superpower means responsibility for the whole world. What kind of responsibility will you assume? India can be a superpower today. But superpower does not have to be only through destructive arms and ammunition or through some kind of geopolitical, you know, intrigue. You can be a superpower today if you can assume responsibility for the freedom of the world. What is global terrorism? Global terrorism is another manifestation of the pathology of unfreedom, which is choreographed by people who do not have a fundamental human growth, who think that dark is white and white is dark. I'm referring to the global arms industry mafia, the military arms complex. Okay? Now, India should not imitate that principle of death. We can be a superpower in being the light of the world. And that was the true destiny of this country. You know, our prophets and seers, the great lights that India produced, you know, when the West looks at us, there are 2 completely different attitudes to India. And that was, at least from the 19th century, I have seen it. After Indology began to be taught in European universities, 19th century, then of course 20th century became climax. The 2 contrary reflections are, one, India is a land of darkness and error. The other is that India is a spiritual continent. These 2 completely contrary understandings of India coexisted in Europe for a long time. I am convinced that India is meant to be, historically mandated to be, a continent of light. But that light must shine. It must shine through you and you and people like us. And it must spread. It must spread everywhere. So, if you are 2 members of this group, I want you to come into a state of responsibility. reach out to others. Okay, let light prevail. Now we'll have tea and come back. Okay, and then you're free to ask me any question you want. Okay, not that I'm going to answer, but you can ask any question.